At this point, we're going to introduce and bring Noah to life with his microphone. Noah is one of our consultants at Regennabis. He's got an extensive background in many things, but certainly in ESG. Noah's been working with us on the build out of something that we'll also be launching in the coming weeks, which is a learning module of around ESG. Most things that one might see about ESG and what is it, why is it important, etc., typically comes from an invest perspective. and I know back in the day, Noah did a bit of work with, for example, the Corporate Finance Institute, which also looked at, you know, positioning why this is important, but from an investor perspective. What we're looking at is how do we position then such learning modules for cannabis practitioners, people in the cannabis business somewhere, no matter which vertical they're in. So what Noah is going to do is just sort of give us a flavor and just a few slides, gonna sort of give us a sense of what such a course would entail and how then we will enable folks to see and undertake this learning. We're going to add some gamification to it, so it's not just a straightforward, you know, module of 20 minutes. There'll be some little sort of tests, if you like, at the end of these modules. And so stay tuned for that, because we'll be launching that on learning management platforms and making sure that folks have the capability of undertaking that learning. He also, of course, works with us on engagements and implementations. So you're going to be seeing a lot more of Noah over the coming weeks, months, years, until we've very firmly embedded ESG right into the heart of this industry and then beyond. So Noah, your mic is working. You're up and running.
All right. Well, thanks everyone for joining. And I just want to reiterate how thrilled I am to be here with you all and to be a part of what Patrick, Jeff, and Kelly are building here. It's remarkable. And it's really exciting to see just the involvement and support from other companies like all yourselves. So I will share screen here and just speak to a few slides that, as Jeff mentioned, speak to some of the educational content we're developing, as well as just walking through a few very recent and very real case studies from adjacent industries in big food and bev, as well as CPG and food production, to be able to draw some parallels to the emerging opportunity for the cannabis industry in the ESG space and the relevance it provides as the industry continues to expand and mature. So what is ESG? Stands for environmental, social, and governance. Environmentally refers to really the company's environmental stewardship, the combined impacts of the company's, the combined impacts on the environment from the company's business activity. Social generally refers to how a company engages and creates value with its stakeholders, which includes, you know, its customers and suppliers, investors, employees, local communities. And then lastly, governance refers to how a company is being ultimately led. So what does this really all mean when it comes together? It provides a framework, ESG provides a framework for changing economic, environmental, and social conditions. So just to put that in context, all of the climate change impacts that have disrupted the supply chains and business continuity for companies around the world. From a social perspective, just look at COVID and how it's impacted the business continuity and ability for companies to compete. And then governance, how are companies managing these compounding challenges in really providing an outlet for stakeholders to engage and collaborate with the company? So this is the all-encompassing, what is ESG? When we think specifically about the issues, ESG issues are wide flung. They are described differently in different contexts, but ultimately it comes down to these core issues of a company's environmental stewardship, that stakeholder engagement and value creation, and then all of the policies and systems and oversight structures for governance. Some of these are sector specific, some agnostic. These days, just beyond the cannabis and hemp industries, climate change and DEI seem to be the most thematically consistent issues across the board in terms of what presents risk and opportunity to the business and what stakeholders are communicating are critically important to them. So it's important to remember that ESG didn't pop out of the past year or two, but it's actually been a continuous evolution going back to the 80s. So looking at environmental health and safety, where it started, which was really compliance driven and looking at reduction of litigation and fatalities in facilities. And then in the 1990s and 2000s, sustainability, do less bad, was the next iteration. Let's reduce our environmental impacts. Then there was CSR, which really became, let's do more good and engage on social issues that are relevant to the communities that we exist in. And really that social license to operate was critical in that CSR framing of this work. But now we're looking at ESG, which is really a all-encompassing framework for risk and opportunity management. So when we think about those changing environmental, social, and economic conditions, it's how a company reacts to those conditions and creates value and sustains a competitive advantage is what the modern ESG moniker refers to. So what's been bringing ESG to the mainstream over the years? Let's look at a couple key issues here. One was the recognition that these issues present material risk and returns. These create very real risks and opportunities to manage from a financial perspective. From a stakeholder demands perspective, there was greater pressure for corporate transparency, better traceability, better oversight mechanisms, and really more accountability for things that were happening outside of the immediate purview of the company. Think local community impact, supply chain management, what the company was doing internally to build capacity of its employees. And then lastly, the regulatory perspective, the regulatory issue. It was becoming known that ESG was equated with effective management for these emerging risks and opportunities, especially after the 2008 financial crisis. So these compounding issues here really created this mainstream notion of ESG and moved it back from EHS to sustainability, to CSR, and to now where we are with ESG. So now when we think of ESG and the new normal of business, in the past year or two, ESG has grown into the mainstream after really the events of these past few years with COVID, global reckoning on systemic racism, greater stakeholder demands for corporate transparency on everything they were doing on their supply chains. So it really became a mainstream concept after this year of these big global events. Climate risk was recognized as financial risk, noted by the Federal Trade Commission and the SEC and all the global financial entities that have recognized that climate change is a very real direct risk to the financial world. Similarly, all of these global disclosure regulations from the SEC disclosure regulations that will be formalized in Q1 of 2022 to all of the evolutions in the EU and the UK around requiring climate risk disclosures of a broader set of companies. And this is continuing to evolve almost on a daily basis from an international level. And then lastly, the last two big factors that have made ESG really table stakes, especially for public companies, has been the recognition that the majority of the adverse environmental and social impacts that are really happening outside of the purview of the company across its supply chains. Jeff and Patrick had mentioned human rights violations. All of these issues that were really far flung on another side of the world because of social media and greater stakeholder interest have now become critical issues for a company to manage and clearly communicate. And then lastly, just the eroded public trust, the great, all of the sort of political division, all of the trust lost when greenwashing litigation has happened due to improper ESG reporting. Think of Allbirds and Oatly as two prime examples, sustainability sweethearts of Wall Street, improper reporting, greenwashing litigation, and destruction of stakeholder trust. So these are some real contextual examples of these things coming to life. And then lastly, we can't ignore the demographic issue. With millennials poised to take over 75% of the workforce and clearly having preferences for both working for and patroning more environmentally and socially conscious businesses, every company will have these requirements from their workforce, as well as from consumers, as millennial consumers and Gen Z consumers. So you're looking at that demographic trend bringing ESG really to the forefront. So now let's talk about, you know, we've talked about what ESG is, what got us here, why it's moved into the mainstream. And now let's really talk about how does we use ESG to drive growth. And this is really critical in part of the Regennabis education program about using ESG to drive operational, strategic, and financial outcomes. So let's put some of this into context, because I know it's one thing to talk about these from a high level, but it's another to give some real nuts and bolts examples. So just as we break down, what are the ESG value propositions to the cannabis and hemp industries? We look at first operational, from risk management to business continuity to optimizing your natural resource stewardship and increasing your operational efficiency. Strategically, we're looking at brand differentiation and increasingly saturated marketplace, that local license to operate, and that ability to discover new customer needs, new markets, and new opportunities for collaboration. And then lastly, financially, we're looking at cost of capital and investment attraction being a critical outcome from robust ESG work. You're able to command premium prices on your products and services, and you're also reducing your regulatory risk exposure for these emerging disclosure regulations. So that's broadly the operational, strategic, and financial opportunities that ESG provides. But I'd love to go now show you a couple real case studies from work that I've done in the past year outside of the cannabis industry, yet the parallels I think are gonna be easy to draw. And I think you'll notice the thematic consistencies here in these case studies. So the first example is a Fortune 500 private label food company, the largest private label food company in North America. The situation was that we were doing ESG work and it immediately became clear there was no formalized approach to environmental issues anywhere. Every single production facility was doing its own thing and shooting from the hip. So what did we do? Super basic employee engagement exercise of the actual internal team, not an energy audit company, but the folks working in the facility did an energy treasure hunt as a employee engagement ESG initiative. And that single plant, from the wisdom of the staff working there, millions in energy and water savings from an annual basis were discovered in a single facility. So then that process that was used in that one facility was standardized as an in-house environmental management system and scaled to the, you know, plus 100 other facilities in Canada, the US, and Italy. You can imagine what the cost, what the operational and financial value was of implementing this system that saved millions of dollars annually at a single facility and standardizing and scaling them to their global facilities, which is still in the works right now. So that's one very real example of the operational and financial value using a food production company as a use case. Let's look at another, you know, big food and bev company, a Fortune 500 food distribution company, and the strategic and financial value here with ESG. And this is speaking both to the company and to a brand that it acquired. So when you're thinking of the cannabis and hemp companies, think about this for a distributor and a brand. So the situation was this company is looking to acquire a coffee company to sell a private label coffee service in their food distribution clients. The action essentially was in the bidding process to buy a coffee company. The one ESG-centric company that had very clear ESG positioning, very clear paper trail for the impacts that it was espousing, they were able to win that bid. And the results were, not only were the coffee company as an ESG-centric company stood out from the from the masses strategically and from a brand differentiation standpoint, the food distribution company, the buyer, was able to leverage the ESG positioning of that coffee company to demonstrate they had a sustainable coffee company in-house and they were able to secure more commercial contracts by speaking to the great work of this coffee company's supply chain management. So very real example of the differentiated value on both ends here from a supplier and B2B buyer perspective. And then lastly, the last case study I'll just speak to quickly is, I'm not gonna say who, but a public plant-based meat company. And there was significant operational, strategic, and financial value from doing ESG work. So the situation was terrible ESG ratings and rankings, bright red, high risk from institutional shareholder services, you know, Fidelity, Sustainalytics, everyone saying high risk, high risk, high risk. Inherently being a sustainable company, being a plant-based company. And the other situation was, as they were expanding internationally, there was significant volatility in supplier fulfillments and in turn, customer satisfaction, because all of the, you know, all of the inconsistencies and volatilities in B2B transactions were causing quite a bit of operational challenges. So what did we do? We took the really the focus at the product level of sustainable products and expanded that focus to include operations and supply chain management. So they were able to expand the sustainable features of their company by demonstrating that they are implementing sustainable management companies across their supply chains with their stakeholder partners. And we also went and formalized the piecemeal elements of an ESG strategy and integrated and aligned them so that all of the best practices that were being executed internally were standardized, scaled, and everyone trained upon them so that there was consistency in the ESG strategy from an enterprise level. And then lastly, we created a supplier code of conduct. Suppliers had no formal guidance on what it was expected of them from a governance perspective, from how they were gonna manage the contract and what they were gonna do to maintain compliance. And the results after these three actions were raised ESG ratings and rankings across the board by showing better operational elements of the work they were doing and clear paper trails for all of that data, enhanced investor support and external recognition. This company went on later this year to win, you know, best companies for the earth, best companies for the planet. Their institutional shareholder services scores shot up. And lastly, they were able to enhance their ability to retain those B2B customers and reduce the fulfillment order errors by having better supply chain management and better capacity building with their suppliers who are looking to integrate and execute these more sustainable practices. So that was that was the very quick, what is the quick and dirty of what is ESG, why is it relevant, and what are some examples? And yeah, I guess I'll open it up or pass it to Jeff and Patrick or open it up to questions.
Oh, yeah, that was great. Patrick, you were just about to say something.
No, I wasn't. No. Oh.
I was. I have a couple questions.
Go right ahead.
Are there ESG rankings and ratings for cannabis companies yet? And if so, who is performing those? And if not, who should we get to perform them? And how heavy a lift is that to operationalize in our industry?
I can take that, and Noah, you can chime in too, I'm sure. It's a brilliant question, very insightful question, because frankly, the answer is no one yet. And therein lies a great opportunity, and one that we feel at Regennabis we're going to jump into. Right now in any industry, no matter whether it's cannabis or otherwise, there is no standardized reporting process. There's no real sort of standardized approach. There are many frameworks, whether you're using a SASB approach or a GRI, which is Global Reporting Initiative approach. There's no standardization, and there's certainly no standardization in the cannabis industry. And the challenge that even the publicly listed cannabis companies have is that when, for example, one of the indexes like MSCI or Refinitiv, when they're looking to undertake an ESG score of a cannabis company, which generally is can only up until now really is being undertaken because of data that's in the public domain. There, one of the challenges they have is, for example, let's just say it was Organigram. They're comparing that in a sector with a whole bunch of other medical and or pharmaceutical type companies. And therefore, we're not really comparing apples with apples. We're comparing them probably with apples with elephants, because they're not even fruits. So that's part of the challenge that we have. But I, as I said, it's an opportunity that we see at Regennabis for sure. We feel that if we can begin to create a series of ESG reports and work in this space, then we can begin to undertake comparisons in different verticals. So obviously across, for example, if the vertical is the cultivation space, or it's the distribution space or the retail space, whatever it is, we can begin to demonstrate that. So that's absolutely needed in the industry, but I think it'll be welcomed if and when we get that right. So that's something that we're going to undertake at Regennabis. Noah, you got something to add?
Yeah, in terms of the difficulty of doing, of you know, when the rubber meets the road, it's a lot easier than I think the headlines make it to be. Great example, energy treasure hunt, right, with the employees. Took an hour, millions of savings discovered by things like inefficient, you know, different hoses being on when it's not operating, or the light switch is remaining on during the break, you know, the break period, like very basic things that are only addressed if there's some intent in figuring out what's going on, right? And then standardizing and scaling that, you know, I think it's probably one of the easier elements of the work, the operational elements here with, you know, natural resource stewardship. The hard part, I think, ultimately is the supply chain supplier capacity building, because you're looking at a deep amount of, you know, deep amount of person-to-person collaboration. You're looking at a lot of positive affect needing to be there to be able to help them build capacity, you know, keep them reassured that they're not going to lose their contracts, and also help them to essentially take on the challenges that your company is paying the bill for or losing from, because their impacts become your business. And it really becomes that, you know, you are your brother's keeper for your suppliers. So I think that's really where the complexity happens. But beyond that, you know, deep going past tier one suppliers and all the way to sourcing, the kind of in-house work, I think, is much more straightforward than, you know, the optics appear to be.
Okay, that's well taken. So another question I have. So the idea, I think the idea of this presentation and learning about what Noah does is that this is what Regennabis wants to do. We want to go into these companies like Noah did with the food companies, and we want to figure out sort of a individualized program, but based on certain offerings that we repeat over and over again. One of those offerings might be figuring out how to rank people. because if I want to buy cannabis packaging, if I had a ranking, I could look up for the packaging company and their suppliers, and I could look up that what they were doing. It could be very helpful, right? And I can imagine that's a really heavy lift. Something like a treasure hunt inside these facilities that already exist. We all tour these indoor grow facilities. We all see the energy getting burned around us all over the place. So I could imagine that, especially if the offering was, hey, look, we're going to organize this cool employee engagement thing. Which I can tell you, not a lot of cannabis companies that aren't run by the Christines of the world are doing right now. it's all about the shareholders in big companies right now, not the employees. But I think you can still convince them to come on in and do one of these treasure hunts. And then maybe the fix is to make the results of that treasure hunt a little bit, make the place a little more efficient, isn't so expensive. than, say, you know, putting cogeneration in and or getting a rebate from the energy company, but by putting a giant natural gas generator next to a, you know, indoor grow, because that's the only way to even come close to making an indoor grow at all. So you know, it's smart to have something like that treasure hunt. That was a great thing I learned about, and maybe that's an offering Regennabis can get going, that that's a little bit easier for people to say yes to. What I'm finding is, as a consultant, I'm having a hard time getting people to want to take the risk and investment into the ESG. And they're so exuberant about making their businesses work financially with the public policy and the frameworks being so bad, that it's very hard for folks to focus on this, even when you're pounding the drum. I'm so thrilled that you're going to have examples at the UN of people who are committed to this and people who are doing this, like Christine and like others, so that the world can see that you can do this. You know, I was on a regenerative farm Sunday having a beautiful infused dinner down in Watsonville. And I was so encouraged because, wow, it still exists in California. Someone can still have a small regenerative farm and survive somehow here. And so I think that we need to show the examples, yeah. Right? So I'm really—
Yeah, we do. And that's exactly what we're setting out to demonstrate, the art of the possible, that and, you know, we come back to the point that you made in your comments there, specifically around shareholders. You know, shareholders seemingly have this focus on the economic aspects. That's why they're called shareholders as opposed to stakeholders. But even shareholders, at some point, they're going to realize that, frankly, if you're literally leaving the lights on, and there's a whole bunch of other things that are going on where you're wasting money, then that's impacting your bottom line. So even the shareholders who are in this for the green rush, so to speak, can be convinced that there's profits that could be derived if you were just a little bit more sensible about how you're actually operating. And that's just a very, very small example. But there are many, many examples that you know, we wish to build on. And ultimately, the idea is that, you know, these organizations are not performing optimally, which also means that if they are seeking further capital in raises, if they're a private company, or even if they're in the public domain, that ultimately they're you could argue that they're putting in place a barrier to their license to operate. They're not mitigating risks as much as they can do. And investors are becoming increasingly more savvy about where they're going to be investing their money. And we see that. We see that movement. We see that movement's happening outside of the cannabis industry. And it's not just us saying it. It's not a market demand. The regulators will be demanding this more and more, as Noah alluded to. It's already happening in Europe. The SEC here in the United States are in catch-up mode. They're getting there. And so this is coming. We're just trying to accelerate the pace of that change.
Yeah. And also, just to add to that, I see Kelly's got her hand up. Just to, you know, Andrew, a lot of these companies, this is a nascent industry. It's a new industry. A lot of these companies, it's the lack of education and awareness around what actually is ESG and how is it applicable to their business. And how can it be applicable? Is the hump that they need to get over? I think we've talked about some of the examples here as to why it's so important. But I think we're going through a transition in the industry as companies start to think about it. What is it? Let's get some education around it, and then start to talk to organizations that are actually doing it. If you look at Chiron, for example, they've recently released their ESG report 2 months ago. And they're really leading the way now on ESG as a publicly listed cannabis company, and they're building a business around that. It's very interesting to see. A few others that we can talk about again, but I know Kelly's had her hand up there, so
yeah, Kelly, and then Frederica. So Kelly first, please. Too. What was your question?
Yeah, I just wanted to approach that from a different perspective, because it's a great insight. Like, how do you convince management teams at companies to espouse ESG? Well, this isn't, like Noah talked about, this isn't new, and there's a lot of data available. McKinsey does a great job in kind of collating that data. And from an investor standpoint, and that's why I always look at it from an investor standpoint, companies that have ESG process in place consistently generate better returns. And Fortune 500 CEOs that were polled said that they would be willing to spend 10% more on takeouts of companies that have a standardized ESG report. So from a stakeholder perspective, that's key, right? I mean, it's right there. So what they just need a framework. I don't think it's going to be that hard to convince people. I mean, we all do want to improve the environment and everything, but if you know that the company is going to generate more returns just by doing this and then have a greater takeout at the end, it's a no-brainer. You know, from a governance perspective, you have to go down this road. So I think it's just putting that data in front of people. They're really, you know, the alternative choice is, you know, you want to perform poorly, and no board of directors is going to stand behind that. So that's how I look at it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you. Frederica.
So I'm thinking specifically about small business owners, you know, equity applicants, people who do not have deep pockets, people who do not always have the network for acquiring the capital that is necessary. And so I just want to uplift, whether it's a tier system of sorts in terms of lighter lifts, like thing, like smaller things that can be done to start them on the path of ESG. And as they see profits, because we know these businesses usually in the first 3 years, they don't, you know, they're just like making even or barely so. And so things that they can gradually do to go along this road of becoming more sustainable in their business practices, but understanding that everyone, you know, doesn't, they may not have six figures or so to throw at some of the recommendations that may come out. And specifically, I'm always kind of looking at areas where harm can be repurposed. And so when you're talking about, you know, better returns and the takeout and like what position that puts companies in, and when we're talking about branding companies, you know, and you know, highlighting or grading them, excuse me, rating them, this is something that can negatively impact those equity businesses, those businesses that are owned by BIPOC individuals. And so I want to make sure that, and I'm 100% the people's ecosystem is in support of this, right? But I just want to make sure that we are not doing things that can be a detriment to yep. BIPOC business owners. So let's just make sure that we're thinking about that, and whether mm-hmm. there's some kind of tier system in terms of the ratings, whether there's some kind of asterisks that's kind of given of things that are taken into consideration. I think that would be definitely, that's important.
So I'd love to speak to those great points, Frederica. And just to speak to that in some of these examples, all of these companies that were used in these use cases, part of the work we did was develop supplier diversity strategies so that they had economic inclusion across their supply chain. So small BIPOC owned companies have a real, I would say, ESG value proposition for a lot of these companies, because they're looking to increase the diversity of all elements of their operations, from the executive level to who are they, you know, working with in their supply chains. And in terms of those small companies, in tactically, how do you, you know, you're not, you know, have, you know, all this capital to throw around and, you know, transition your company from natural gas to completely powered by renewables. I would say a focus on the who is a focus on the how. So deep stakeholder engagement and collaboration provides a lot of opportunity for smaller less resource businesses because you get to leverage each other's assets, networks, infrastructures, mission alignment. One very clear example is looking at your own like diversity employment strategy and looking at working with veteran NGOs, because not only do you get highly trained supply chain managers and logistics managers under stressful situations, the US military is the most diverse organization in the States, and you get a tax incentives for hiring veterans. So you get to check all these boxes by just finding the right NGO that's looking for a corporate partner. So there's a lot of kind of boots on the ground, tactical elements of stakeholder engagement that can be used to essentially anchor a small company's ESG efforts.
That's great. Thank you very much, both, all three of you. Kelly, for the points raised. Frederico, it's a great question. Noah, very eloquently, feeding back to us where some of the opportunities are. And certainly from our perspective at Regennabis, we're, given we're a very purpose-centric, purpose-driven organization, we talk about regenerative growth for all, not only in the cannabis industry, but by the cannabis industry. We recognize and we put it front and center of the work that we're doing, that there are some populations in this industry who continue to be left behind. So we are also thinking long and hard about how do we ensure that, the implementation of programs like this are to scale, and that they're priced accordingly. And it's one of the things as we work increasingly with partners in our environmental social governance work, we think of small, medium-sized enterprises and their capability to pay for such services. So great questions. The hands up, I see Vanessa as a hand up.
Yes, I just had a quick thought on the subject. I like the ESG model. I like that it's really the tone at the top of the organization that would drive it, and the internal control process. And it is a differentiator in the marketplace for these businesses that tack onto it. But if we were to apply this, what I would call kind of the gold standard of ESG, which could possibly be cost prohibitive in some of those smaller businesses, as the speaker was just talking about, what about the problem between states? So I'm in California, and California is highly regulated in terms of the build out of its plants with certain types of lighting and distance to doors and all of that. Whereas you can go to another state and have a facility there that doesn't have those same regulatory requirements that are very expensive in California to do business. And so do you hold them to the California standard, or do you modify the ESG for the state in which they reside? That's my question for Noah.
well, without being a lawyer here, Vanessa, don't take any of my legal advice here. From a management perspective, I would my kind of loaded answer would be, at the end of the day, when people are looking at your brand, they're looking at that logo, they're looking at that, CEO, they're looking at that company's ethos. I don't think they're looking at the fine print of where they're, from a regulatory perspective, either going above and beyond or just kind of playing ball. So I think that consideration would be that if you are doing an enterprise work, it needs to be operationalized across anywhere your brand is present, because it'll all come back from the same sort of stakeholder sentiment. Now, cost prohibitive, of course, you can only do what you can do, to keep the lights on. However, I think, if from a reputational perspective, it would be pretty imperative to make sure that across the board, your ESG strategy was fully integrated across the states you're operating in. Yep. And it's very similar to the global expansion of the plant-based company, where they needed to start aligning what they were doing domestically, internationally, so that they were able to have that clear, both quantitative paper trail from a ESG data perspective, and also from the narrative that it was telling to its stakeholders. I hope that answers the question or gives some thought there, Vanessa.
Yeah, great. I think that's important to understand, just because they're gonna get that stamp, and what does that really mean if it could be a company, you know, just only located in California as opposed to one that's global. But I do get it. I just know the standards are going to vary state to state from what the federal, I know the minimum is federal, right? So we go federal, but then beyond that is state regulation.
Yeah. I think from our perspective also, what this specific question alludes to is also ties back to governance and leadership. And you could argue ethics of leadership. You know, it's one thing to be compliant. It's another to, we think, to lead by going beyond compliance. It's to being future focused and knowing that at some point there will be some expansion, there'll be some geographic or market expansion. And I think it's really what we're also doing with leadership when we speak to leaders in different businesses in the cannabis space, is we're getting them to think forward, that at some point there'll be an event a year, 2 years down the line, and people will ask questions of stuff that happened a year or 2 years before, even 3 years before. And that's all a question of mitigating that risk around those questions, which will come. And so if you're on your, you know, best foot forward and you're saying, we're aware of the lower standards in other states, but we hold ourselves to the highest standards of wherever it is that we're operating or where that we consider that we will be operating, it'll serve you well, we think, to have that position, because at some point that's the kind of question and the drilling into your operations that people will be asking, and it could trip you up. So that's part of the sort of ethics of leadership as far as we're concerned. That's great. Any other questions? Am I getting that? Okay, great. Thank you for the questions. Noah, just to, we're top of the hour, I wanted to say thank you to you for a great introduction to the topic. We're gonna take some of these recorded assets and create them into a video that we can release and we can share on social media. But it's really helpful to go this very high level, this notion of what is ESG and around the why and the how, and what that means from a strategic, financial, and operational perspective. The use cases are great because I think that's when people can really begin to see the impacts and the possible impacts. And so I think it's really helpful for us to continue to find cases and that, you know, through either work that we've done or we know that others have done, but to really sort of point out that this is a best foot forward. So thank you, everyone. We're at the top of the hour. Unless there are any burning questions, just to say a huge thank you to everybody for joining us today. Thank you to Noah for these great insights, and as well as your answers to the questions. Unless there's anything else, thanks everybody, and best of luck this week, and happy Thanksgiving if you are observing.
Happy Thanksgiving.
Thank you all.
Thanks everybody.
Thanks all. Happy
Take care. Bye now.
Bye-bye. Thanks, Noah.
See you guys.
Bye-bye.